The design tool Play has a game-changing new feature called Play to Xcode. And to put it simply, all these beautiful designs that your designer took hours and hours to make, agonizing over every little detail, every little corner radius, gradient, interactions, animation timing, reflections, all of that, you don't have to recreate that in code. Because with Play to Xcode, you can export your Play project, all the components, all the colors, as a package right into Xcode, so you as a developer can use entire screen flows or individual components like puzzle pieces to use in the UI however you like, and you don't have to rebuild the design from scratch, which is going to save you so much time and improve that developer-designer relationship. Because the designer won't have to nitpick the app because you didn't build it exactly to spec, you're using exactly what they designed. This video is sponsored by Play, which is a design tool that helps build native iOS apps. And what's unique about it is that it uses SwiftUI concepts. So in the design tool, you're using VStacks, HStacks, etc. So if you're a developer and you like building your app first in a design tool, it'll feel very familiar to you. And if you're on a team with a designer, I highly recommend you going to your designer and saying, hey, check out Play, because now you and your designer will speak the same language when it comes to building UI. You'll both speak SwiftUI. I've already done a video all about Play, I'll link to that in the description. This video is going to focus specifically on the brand new feature, Play to Xcode, where you can just export all your Play designs and you don't have to rebuild them in Xcode. Here I am in the design tool, Play, and what we're simulating here is I have an awesome designer that designed this, built these screens, built all the animations, all the interactions, and they give me a design file and say, here, developer, make this work in Xcode. And again, why Play to Xcode is such a big deal is because all the little details you don't have to rebuild. Let's take a look at this card, for example. See how there's an image, and then the gradient pulls the main color from the image and applies that gradient. Look at the little bookmark button, how there's like an inner shadow, and the image from below is slowly peeking in. I mean, there's so many minor details, again, that the designer just painstakingly goes over. And then you as a developer usually have to recreate all that, but not anymore. Let me show you how this thing works in action. So you're gonna hit this publish button up here, and then you see export to Xcode. So again, we're simulating my designer, gave me an awesome design file. I need to make it work in Xcode. So we're gonna export the project, and this is preparing the project, getting the SDK ready. So we're gonna create a brand new Xcode project from this. You can add it to an existing Xcode project. SwiftUI, fonts, images. If you have video assets or audio assets or JSON, you can include those as well. This project doesn't have it. And you can name your module whatever you like. Ours is called Analog Music. You see right here, that's what you'll have to import. So any screen you wanna use, any component from here, you'll have to import Analog Music or whatever you name this. So we're gonna go ahead and hit continue. Now here as a developer, you can customize what comes in, rename things if you need to. So here's all the assets that are built into the app. Maybe you need these, maybe the designer is just using dummy assets to make it look good and you're pulling in real data from the internet. So that depends on your project, but maybe you do have assets you want to pull in. So you would check and uncheck whichever ones you want or don't want. And same thing with styles, you can bring in colors, fonts. And if we go to components, these are the puzzle pieces I was talking about. You see up here in the upper right, this is like a music player. Here we have card large. That's what I showed previously. We have profile header down here. So like I said, these are all the components that you can use as puzzle pieces in your app, and I'm going to show you how to do that so you can put them together however you like to make whatever UI you want. But again, you're not rebuilding all the little details. You're getting the full component that you can just mix and match how you like. And over here on the right, you get the code that shows you how to use it. For example, you're just going to say profile header, but this one has states. So profile header has a default state and a collapse state with a built-in animation. You can see that here. So these components aren't just static view components you bring over. They have interactions, they have animations, they have different states. It's really, really robust. And you'll see that in action in a little bit. So let's export to Xcode, preparing the project. I'll give it the awesome name of Music Player App. Hit save. Now we'll double click on the Xcode project to open it up. And Xcode's gotta load, process all the files, you know, typical Xcode stuff. All right, after all the file processing, here we are, you see pages.splash. So this would be an example of where you can import an entire flow. Now I know, as a developer, you're gonna want control over the navigation. But in certain circumstances, like a very basic onboard flow where it's just a flow of static screens, maybe you're grabbing a little bit of data here and there, but it's not super intensive, this can be really valuable. And I'm gonna challenge you, the developer, as I'm going through these screens, and I'm actually gonna run it on the simulator because, I don't know, it just feels more real to me than the preview, but think as I'm going through these screens, how long would it take you, watch this animation, every little animation, every little detail, every little interaction, how long would this take you to rebuild the UI? Just keep that in mind as we're going through. Again, I just showed you this animation that's going. This is like the intro to the onboard screen. Hit start, we'll navigate to the cover art flow. Look at the reflection, look at the animation. It's interactive, I'm going back and forth as you slide over. And then when you click on one of these, it spins around. That interaction, that animation, look at the little detail of the subtle red radial gradient at the top, and then tapping to go back. So again, this is just one screen we're going through, but there's a lot of little detail, the border going around, the corner radius. Again, so many details that have been taken care of for you by the designer. Let's keep it moving. What about this volume? And look at this interaction with the stretch animation. Look at the stretchiness of the volume. Look at the variable animation on the SF symbol as I go up and down. Again, think of how long this would have taken you to rebuild. Moving on. Selecting the artist. And yes, I know you're the developer thinking, how do I get access to this? Because if you look at the code, it just says pages.splash. Like, what are the variables? How do I know like what's been selected? In Play, the designer can expose certain variables to you when capturing information. Now, I wouldn't recommend, if it's a super data heavy screen, to use Play for that, to have so much data in Play. But again, a simple onboard flow where you just need like a simple array of artists that they selected, perfectly doable. But again, look at the subtle interaction. When I tap it, it gets depressed a little bit, and then the check mark fades away. Bring the check mark back. Again, all these little details, these little interactions. Going on to the next screen, you get a sign up screen for free. Again, you can capture the name and the email, hit sign up. Now you get this little animation, and this is going to take us into the feed. So again, I didn't have to do anything as a developer. That was all right there. Now I may have to capture some data here and there, like the array of artists, you know, the email and password for the signup, but that's very minimal work. But for a flow, like, I got all that out of the box, probably saved me a week or two of work of building all those details, all those reflections, all those gradients, the interactions, the animations. So like I said, for something like an onboard flow that's pretty simple, static screens, maybe you're grabbing a little bit of data here or there, this is great. Again, think about how much time that would have taken you to rebuild that flow. So let's move on to my favorite part of this, and that's not using entire flows, but that's using some of these UI elements like puzzle pieces that I can put in my app where I need to without having to rebuild all the details. All right, so I'll stop running this, and the first one we'll do, we'll go back to that slider. So instead of pages 0.splash, I can do, well, let me actually show you how I know what these are. So if I open up the analog music package dependency over here, sources, analog music, and then components, I can see all the components that I can use. Now I know I can type slider UI, and here we have that UI component. You see, I still got the stretchiness going on. I still got the animation. I can grab the value. I'll show you that in a second, but I'm not stuck with what the designer gave me. Now this is up to you and the team to decide what to expose, but as you see with the slider UI on the initializer, I can get, I'm gonna give them all, we're not gonna use them all. Scroll to max, horizontal stretch, vertical offset, all this stuff. I'm gonna take it down to the symbol, get rid of progress, we'll access that later. I can actually get the progress so I can do something with the volume if I need to as a developer. So we'll say the symbol is wave.3.up. I just pulled that from SF symbols. And then the width, we'll just say 60, right? Just an arbitrary number here. But now look at my volume here. It's a little skinny slider, and now I got the three wave up, kind of like a Wi-Fi signal, but you see, the designer in Play can expose whatever aspect of the component they want, whether it's corner radius, stretchiness, width, height, what SF symbols attached to it. Again, this is all up to the designer in Play to expose things to you that you can adjust in code. So these components are very dynamic. And you may be thinking, hey, it's a volume slider. I need to know like the progress. So as a developer, I can do developer things, right? I may need to change the volume or adjust something else. So on the slider UI, I can do dot on variable change. And then the variable name is .progress. And then here's what I wanna do when the progress changes. So we will print val, and that's this value right here. So I'm gonna run it on the simulator so this prints out in the console. So here, yep, let me move this over, move this up, back to the simulator. So you can see that's full 10 all the way down to 0, and then everything in between. Of course, it's an optional, gotta do all the unwrapping stuff. But the point remains that like you have access to these variables that are exposed in Play. So it's not just a pure UI component that you can't do anything with. The user can interact with it, and I can grab the percentage completed so I can, again, do developer things with that value. So with the slider UI, I showed you how dynamic these can be. If the designer exposes certain properties in Play, you can customize them in code, and they can also expose these values like progress So you don't have to build that interaction in code. You just read out the progress and can do what you need to do as a developer with that value. So super flexible, very dynamic components. All right, Slider UI, cool. What about a signup form? Oh, cool. Just like that, I get a signup form. I didn't have to rebuild that UI. I just got it. And of course, you can grab the name and email values just like we did with the Slider UI. What about card large? Now we're gonna spend some time with this one because right here I'm getting just the card. Let me go back to light mode because the default is black. Back to light appearance because I wanna show you what the card looks like. Cool. Now we just have this one puzzle piece, but what we're gonna do is we're going to put this into a list and I'm gonna show you how you can also pipe data into these UI components. Sure, we could put in dummy data or assets that are actually on device, but most apps don't do that, right? You make a network call, you fetch images, you fetch strings, and then you plug that into UI. Well, here we already have the UI. We just have to make the network call, get the data, and plug it in. Now I'm not gonna actually write the network call because this is all about the UI. Keep the video flowing. I'm going to bring in some code that would simulate that. So I'm gonna paste that under my preview. I'll walk through it real quick so you can see it. So it is basically an album struct. Imagine this being, you know, an album cover art. You have the artist, album title, and a description, and you can favorite it. And there's an interaction built into this card. I'll show you in a little bit. But I know my album is gonna need artist, title, description, cover art, which is the UI image. And then here I just made some dummy data, mock albums. Again, this is simulating, hey, you go out, make a network call. That network call is gonna return some JSON. The JSON is gonna have strings. Gonna have to go fetch the UI image, but I am using the local ones. And by the way, this images.hexkey.ui image. If I minimize my components and go to analog music media, here are all my images. Again, this is what got brought in, kind of the dummy data from the play package. I'm gonna use that just because, again, I'm not gonna actually go fetch images from the internet, but the point remains, right? You get back some JSON, you create a UI image from that JSON. I'm just using ones that are on device right now. So that's what this mock albums is simulating. So let me show you how you can use card large as a puzzle piece to build a list of albums. So to get our list of card large, we will throw this in a navigation stack and it's a scroll view. In that scroll view is going to be a V stack. Could be a lazy V stack, sure, whatever. We'll do spacing of 24. And we need for each data and content. Now we want to iterate through this array of albums, right? This mock albums, it's kind of dummy network call simulator. So for that, we're gonna need at state private var albums. It's an empty array of albums, cool. And then on the scroll view, we'll do a dot task just to simulate that this is a network call. We'll set albums equal to album dot mock albums. So again, simulating, hey, we ran a network call. Now we're setting our albums equal to the mock albums, which is down here. And we're gonna populate our list of cards with that data. Run this through albums, and then the content is album. And then for each album, we want to have a card large. And again, I did not have to rebuild this UI that you're gonna see. And there's some details in this UI that are gonna be really nice that we get for free. So you see, here's my scroll view of card large. Now let's populate it with the data from each album. So play does act a little differently. You don't enter this data through an initializer. You call .set text, and there's various different text elements on the card. You can see an abstract, title, description. So we do dot, and then we get that. And again, this is all exposed by the designer in play. So we'll say the artist is album dot artist. And just to refresh your memory, here's our album struct. We have an artist, title, description, cover art. That's what we're gonna be plugging in here. Dot set text for the album is album dot title. So we called it dot set text for the abstract, which is our description. And then, so that's all the text stuff. Now we'll do set image and the element here, we're gonna do photo because from the photo, it will pull the gradients properly. You'll see that in a second. So photo and then is gonna be album.cover art. And remember that was our UI image that we had down here. For our purposes, we were pulling the images from the package, the dummy data. Again, this would be you download the image data from the network call, create a UI image from it and plug it in there. Now I do wanna give a quick navigation title on my scroll view, dot navigation title, say albums to make this look halfway decent. Oh, and we'll put some padding around this V stack here, too close to the edge. Great, now I have a pretty basic list of album title. But again, I didn't have to build this card. Look at that bookmark with this subtle gradient and the inner shadows. Look at the color matching gradient, right? This gradient is a red gradient that fades down into the album title. Now it's a blue gradient that fades down into the album title. Now it's a green gradient, right? That is all done in the design tool in play. As a developer, I didn't have to build all that. Now let me change my color scheme to dark mode real quick so you can see this interaction I'm about to show you. If I swipe to the right, I can bookmark it and favorite the album and then watch the upper right-hand corner. Let me do that again. I'm gonna unbookmark it or favorite it, save it, whatever you wanna call it, and see that animation. Now watch the upper right again. I'm gonna bookmark it with a swipe. I didn't build that interaction. That was all done in play. And again, that is bookmarked, is favorited, whatever variable you and your designer decide to name it, that could be exposed. And then you can do all your developer things that you need to do with that data. So here's my list of album art that I did not have to do, but I was able to plug in my data. Right now it's dummy data in Xcode, but that could have been a network call that I got. I receive the data, it's dynamic, and I just plug it right into my pre-existing UI puzzle piece component that I didn't have to build. It was done for me by the designer, and better yet, for the developer, I don't have the designer nitpicking, hey, that corner radius isn't quite right. That gradient should be a little different, right? It is exactly what the designer wanted. So that's awesome. So like I said, if you're working on a team, I'm gonna go back to play here, where the designer just spends hours and hours agonizing over every little meticulous detail, send them this video, send them my other video on play, have them check it out, because like I said, they'll start building their UI using VStacks, HStacks, so now you're speaking the same language, and you'll just build a better native iOS app. That developer-designer relationship will improve greatly, and you're just gonna save so much time by not redoing all the designer's work, again, agonizing over every little detail, every animation curve, every interaction, every corner radius, gradient, shadow. You just don't have to worry about any of that as a developer. So if you're a SwiftUI developer that likes to build your apps in a design tool first before you get in code, play's a no-brainer. Again, you're gonna be using VStacks, HStacks, all that stuff. And if you're on a team building native iOS apps and your designer's using Figma, Sketch, or whatever other design tool, have them check out Play. The link will be in the description.